I mean, at one point it was really funny. I said to my friend, I'm like, if I die on my celebrate being alive day, I'm going to come back and kill you. Like, hello, 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 and welcome to Well Shit. It really is that simple. I'm Claire.
And I'm Serena. On this podcast, we help you to understand about your 12 universal needs, why they are currently not being well met,
how to meet them in ways that work for you, and how to consistently do so in quick, easy, and simple ways that fit seamlessly into your life.
We'll also help you to understand how doing so will have a positive ripple effect in literally every area of your life.
If you like what you hear, sign up for more support with meeting your needs with your weekly Universal Needs Notes at theuniversalneeds.com.
And enjoy the show.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hey, everyone. Well, here we are.
It's spooky season, right?
It is spooky season. We're not sure if it's going to be spooky season when you actually get to see this because we're having some technical difficulties, but we're still recording. And it's not really spooky season that has me kind of shifty-eyed right now.
it's kind of spooky season where you are, though, right?
Yes. Yes, it is. In this room, it is, too. There is a unwanted guest. This guest was not invited to join the podcast today.
And Serena has a live studio audience right now.
I do have a live studio audience. There is a spider in my room, and it's too high up where I can't get it. And I have come a long way in my arachnophobia. There used to be a time where you couldn't say the word spider without me getting all tippy toes about it and like, ooh.
We're going to need a spider trigger warning on this episode. You realize this now.
Yeah. And it's one of, like I was telling Claire, it's one of those like really dark furry ones with the little like antenna thing. Like I feel like when they have the little like almost like fangy flipper things in the front, it makes them so much scarier because then when they look right at you, it's like they're pointing to you and it's a jumping spider, which I've seen on Facebook and it's like, oh, they're so cute with all their eyes and their little furs. No.
Like, when they're in an enclosure, yeah, maybe.
Yeah, so if you see me looking, if you're watching the video and you see me looking all like weird, that's why. If you see me flailing, I might be okay, but it's just a spider.
If I'm flying at some point, it's because something has jumped in Serena's direction.
He was a little close to me and it was doing like that kind of, like, I'm familiar with jumping spiders. Like, they've never been my, you can drop from the sky and then you jump like straight back. No.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Yeah. Ugh. Nope, I'm creeping myself out.
And it's funny because we both have issues with arachnophobia. Like at one point, I remember many, many years ago, my parents went on vacation and it was when I was still living at home. And there was a huge, now I'm from the UK, so huge spiders in our sense are not huge compared to the rest of the world. But this was like, I'm used to like the spindly little house spiders. I don't like them particularly, but this one was a big, thick, legged thing, which we don't really experience over there. And I remember I was at the time, I had my boyfriend at the time was in Zurich, which obviously wasn't helpful. I called him. He's like, I don't know what you expect me to do. And I'm like, I don't know either. It was like midnight. So I went to, I went to call a friend of mine that lived around the corner to be like, hey, would you, I know this is ridiculous, but I'm not going to be able to sleep with this thing here. And I went to get the phone and by the time I got back to the bedroom, it had disappeared. And I basically slept on the couch for 2 weeks. After my mom and dad got back from vacation, she found it in my, and she was at that point, she's like, oh, I get it now. Like it wasn't like, that wasn't just Claire being ridiculous. So yeah, both of us have some challenges with the, eight-legged friends.
Well, like. And we're both, I used to be a smusher throat. Like I would go for it. My mom always said, you know, if they're not in my area, I'm okay. And I'm like, nope. If I can see them, I'm not okay. Now, like, I prefer to err on the side of catch and release. And I've actually done so with spiders, which my best friend from childhood, she's like, every so often, she's like, wow, you've come a long way. Living in an RV, like, you kind of have to. There's a lot of creepy, crawly things. But, like, he's looking at me right now. And I'm just kind of, like, No.
Dude. No way. And it's so funny because like one of my best friends has literally just purchased one of these as a pet. So it's kind of funny. I've like got my two best friends. Like, one of them is like actively encouraging them into her home and the other one's like, get the fuck out. Like, right. You're not welcome here.
I'll get you a box if that's what you want, if you'll just chill in there. Like,
so yeah, this is really relevant to what we're talking about today. We're not completely just going off on a spooky random tangent. I could understand why you would think we might. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's rare for us in this, you know, in our world. So.
So while we're not talking about spooky things necessarily, today what we're talking about is we're talking about how when you are when you run a business, when you're in a kind of customer facing role within a business, that it's really important to get as much information about what your clients' needs are and what will compromise their needs to ensure that you are delivering service that is going to actually match that. And it, and if you're thinking, oh, I'm not, this is not relevant to me because this is business stuff and da da da, hold that thought, because I'm actually going to, I'm going to kind of connect this into, actually, this is relevant to pretty much any relationship in life. But we'll get to that a little bit later. But the reason this all came about, the reason we started thinking about this is that as most of you, and probably if you are avid listeners, go. It's so funny because I'm aware of how much this spider is moving around the room just because I can see where Serena's eyes are moving compared to where they were a short while ago.
Tune in, followed my adventure.
I'm like, if the mic goes flying, you know what's happened. So most of you listening, if you're avid listeners, you will know that every year on October 12th, I celebrate my annual celebrate being alive day, which is the anniversary of when I was lying.
Yay! Why isn't jazz hands something? Like, this should be something fabulous. This should be glitter.
If you're listening on the audio and like, what's going on? There are certain things that you can do that will create different...
Certain things I can do, apparently.
Yeah, I don't know why it's not working for me. I think I must have turned them off, but I don't know how I've turned them off. Anyway, so... Serena was getting confetti to happen on the screen because it was my celebrate being alive day. That's what's happened. Like, if you're in the audio going, what the hell is going on right now? I have no idea what's happening. Welcome to the club. We're not really sure either. No, we are. We are on track. So every year on October 12th, it's the anniversary of when I was lying on the beach wearing noise cancelling headphones and one of the sand trucks that rakes the sand to kind of smooth it down because we don't have tides the way that most people do because we have a reef off of the shore here, reversed over me when I was lying on the beach and I came very, very close to being, talk about being squished. I came very close to being squished. And as it turned out, the only reason
too that soon.
The only reason that I wasn't was because the driver of the truck had to get out to move a trash can that was in his way. So it was a very, very close call for me. Very, like, way close, too close for comfort, if I'm being honest. So every year we celebrate, I'm still here. So normally Serena is a big part of those celebrations. And this is the first year I've actually celebrated that without her being here, because normally we celebrate that together. There's actually one year we didn't, which was the COVID year, but we did it via Zoom. So we were still together and celebrating. But Serena's been an active part of those celebrations pretty much since its inception. And this year, we had another friend that was kind of spearheading the celebrations. And we did some really fun things. Like, we went and created bubble art. We got a pedicure. We had a little dance party out on the pier with bubbles. It was a very fun day. There was one part of the day that wasn't as much fun as I would have liked it to have been. He managed to get some tickets to a local escape room. And I've always wanted to do an escape room. I've never done one. And the only thing is that they're doing this seasonal thing at the moment where they have, it's like a haunted escape room. And as part of this haunted escape room, they have live actors in there that are creating a scary experience. Now, I think we've talked about this on the podcast before. Serena and I have very different relationships with being scared for entertainment factor. So Serena is normally try your hardest to scare the living shit out of me. And I will probably still see you coming a mile away and will probably laugh at you when you're trying. That's generally, I mean, I think that's a pretty accurate demonstration. Like, representation, wouldn't you say, of where you're at with getting scared with things?
Yes, I like being scared. I like haunted houses. I actually don't like being scared, but I like the adrenaline of being scared. Like, it's weird, right. Which I kind of do like being scared. I still don't know where I land on that, but I love, like I love haunted things, just not, I mean...
But also, like, a lot of them, like, they don't scare you. Like, a lot of them, you'll be like, yeah, exactly. And that's exactly what I said. That's, I think, the bit that you missed when there was a disconnect. So I am of the, I do not like being scared. I don't like being scared. I don't like being made to jump. I don't like anything. As we've shared in previous episodes, we did a haunted mangrove tour many, many years ago. And, Serena was in a kayak in front of me laughing and I was a few back. And when I got off the other end, she was laughing at me. And I was like, what's so funny?
Oh, no, I went through the hole. There's like one little hole in this thing and he went right through that. Little guy, come on. I don't want to smush you. Feels like a Monday today.
I don't know what day it feels like today. Yeah. I take it the jumpit spider has exited the room now.
I'm not sure. He flew out on a magic plastic lid ride. He could be anywhere from the end of the bed to the kitchen. So, but I'm back.
Okay, so we did the Haunted Mangroves tour and we got to the other end and Serena was laughing and I'm like, what's so funny? She was like, well, what did you say?
You're screaming in British.
She said, you even scream with an accent. And I'm like, how is that even a thing? Like,
I didn't know it was a thing until I heard it. I was like, we were in the kayak. Like, at this point, they were like solidly in the mangroves, and we were in the harbor area. And there was no denying who was getting scared. It was, I couldn't even like, I could probably try to recreate it, but there is no way that I could because I don't even know what it was.
I still don't know what it is that makes my scream British versus American. But anyway, we digress. Yep. How? I don't. And... Yeah. Anyway. So anyway, we went into this, we were going into this escape room and just to give context, we were stood outside and then we heard the screams of the people that were in there that were just exiting. And I'm like, I don't know if I want to do this anymore. I'm not sure. Now, is it like, I can push myself to do stuff like that, but I'm long past the point of doing something to prove I can do it now. I'm like, if I'm going to enjoy it, I'll do it. If I'm not going to enjoy it, fuck it. I'm not doing it. Like, there's no point. Like, in my earlier years, I would have tried to do something to prove I could do it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can I do it? Absolutely. Do I want to? Am I going to enjoy it? No. If I'm not going to enjoy it, life's too fucking short. I'm not doing it. So I was like, oh, I'm not really sure. And the friend I was there with had spoken to the people ahead of time and had warned them, like, I don't want to be scared. Can they tone it down? Da, 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 da. And so I thought that it was going to be like a very mild version of it. There were two big issues with this. The first thing was that there were different people in there who were these live actors. And some of the actors got the memo and some of the actors really didn't get the memo and didn't realize how uncomfortable I was with being scared. The other issue is that in an escape room, you're supposed to be like looking around and looking under things and opening things to try and figure out how to get out of the room. The problem is I was so afraid of somebody jumping out and making me and scaring me that I didn't want to touch anything. I didn't want to go anywhere. I spent half of the time like cowering behind the other friend that I was there with. And so also I didn't get the enjoyment of the escape room that I would have liked to have got because I really wanted to do the escape room, but I couldn't do the things that were going to mean I was going to be, because I like problem solving. I love that kind of stuff. So it was like, I didn't get to have that experience. So a lot of it was like, they were like giving us clues and things, either the live actors or there was like a voiceover. There was a mic. There were like speakers and obviously a person who had a mic who was kind of letting us know what the situation was and like giving us hints about. And that was the thing. I didn't really want hints, but I didn't have another choice because I couldn't find the clues because I was terrified. And there was like one room, there was like somebody who was like repeatedly made us really jump badly, like big bang sounds, like out of the blue. And I'm like, I'm really not liking this. And I mean, at one point it was really funny. I said to my friend, I'm like, if I die on my celebrate being alive day, I'm going to come back and kill you. Like, Like, it was just, but, and so here's the thing, is that there were a number of different rooms. I think there were four different areas that you had to go to. Now, the interesting thing was the third room was like a pirate themed room. Now, I didn't find this out until after the event, but it turns out the live actor in that room was the owner of the escape room. And this guy picked up really quickly that we did not want to be scared. And I, because I'm very intuitive and I'm kind of energetically sensitive to people, I felt his energy shift as soon as he figured it out. And at that point, I knew I was okay in that room. I knew I was safe. Now, interestingly, the other person I was there with didn't have that kind of same awareness. And so was still like, every time there was any sound was like, oh, oh, yeah. And I'm like, no, you're fine. And I didn't know how to tell him we're fine. Like, I know he's not going to make us jump. But the thing was, at that point, I relaxed and I enjoyed the room and I enjoyed the puzzle. I enjoyed solving the puzzle in that room because at that point, I wasn't so afraid of being scared. And that taking that fear away meant that I got to actually enjoy the experience. Now, the latter room that we went into, this guy was not in. There were two other people in there who didn't realize that tone down means don't scare me, basically. Mm-hmm. And at one point, like, this woman came in and she was wearing a mask and everything, came, like, appeared right behind us and made a noise. And I jumped out of my skin and literally ran and kind of cowered behind the friend that I was there with. And now, apparently, the last scene in this thing was supposed to be really scary. And that's what the other people were screaming about. And they didn't do that final scene. But they didn't realize that it wasn't like, oh, let's not do the extreme scare thing. It's don't scare these people. Mm-hmm. And I would have far rather them to be, I mean, the very fact that there were live actors in there, that would have, I mean, I'm probably going to, that's kind of going to make me jump where there's a person there I'm not expecting to be there anyway. But this is the thing. And like Serena and I were talking about this afterwards. And this is like, this is just an example. And it just happens to be a spooky example that matched with Serena's unwelcome guest today. But I think that the key thing here is that the more information you can find out about the clients that you're working for, the better you can ensure that, one, their needs are supported by the interactions, but two, and this is the big one, this is the most important one, that their needs aren't compromised by your interaction with them. Now, the interesting thing is we have an entirely different experience that we're dealing with as a business right now, dealing with another business that is providing us horrendous customer service. And the issues in the customer service that we are getting are causing delays. It's the reason that we didn't get to release a podcast last week. It's the reason that we don't know whether we're going to be able to release a podcast this upcoming week. I mean, obviously for you guys, we will have released, but it will probably be a couple of weeks delayed because we won't have been able to do it. And this is the thing, they don't seem to realize that their issue, the issues that they are creating, and they are issues that they're creating. And we were like, we've been sold one thing and now we're finding out that the criteria are very different. And these are compromising our business needs and also compromising our individual needs because the interactions are causing so many issues. And so, yes, I mean, we're not doing a podcast just aimed at people who do haunted houses. That's very, very, very niche. I'm not sure that our audience for that would be very big, but we thought about this and we were saying, like, as a haunted house, it would be really good is if you have people coming in that you give them like a one question survey. What level of fear factor do you want in this? Do you want us to scare the living shit out of you at the top, which is the number 5? Do you want to not be scared at all? You don't mind, just mind that there's like a creepy doll over there or a fake arm or limb over there or something. Like, yeah, it's still got a creepy vibe. It's still not an enjoyable place to be. Like, there's creepy dolls like making like with little girl laughter and like saying I can see, like, it's still creepy as fuck in there, even mm-hmm. if you're not being actively scared. But it's like, do you want no scare? Do you want a little bit of scare? Do you want like kind of mid-level? Do you want, okay, we want a bit more intensity, or do we want like scare the living fuck out of me right now? And it's like that one question and giving that kind of gradient and having very clear indicators to the people who are in there of like, okay, if we're on a level 1, You sit, you don't say anything, you're just there. A level two, maybe like at one point as we walked in, the one of the actors was like, fresh meat. And I'm like, wasn't really scary. I mean, it scared me when I didn't, because I didn't initially realize he was there. But I'm like, that's like a level one kind of scary.
It's,
you know,
not
what
the
I mean?
Person coming after you with a chainsaw.
That part.
And I kind of get like, I hadn't, I got notes. I can make a note. You keep going. I can make a note.
No, it's a cool part to be. Okay. Jump in. Don't jump on it.
Okay. If you don't know what I'm doing, we'll throw the link in. A couple of podcasts ago, we decided to help manage our ADHD and still keep the podcast going. We're going to make notes. And then I just remembered, I can make a note. went off on that note rabbit hole, didn't you, Serena? When you were saying earlier, like, the people didn't get the memo to tone it down. And it's like, if I'm working at a haunted house, like, I can imagine my baseline. My baseline is going to be way above most people's normal.
A lot of screaming in British.
Yes. I love haunted houses. Like, I've been to so many. I know the character I would be and how creepy it would be. And, like, you know, what would I want to, how would I want to be scared? And if you told me to tone it down, my tone it down would still probably be above most people's baseline. So, like, having specific, you know, this is what one is, this is what two is. And I get people like, well, in a haunted house, like, how can you tell? There are ways people can have light up wristbands. All right. If you see the orange light, that means, like, come on. Or, you know what I mean? Like, there are ways to do it. And there's always a way to compromise so that we're doing things in, like, a self first way and to meet the needs and not compromise the needs of others. Like, it might be a little bit more work, a little bit more difficult. There may be some, like, challenges with getting it right, but, like, we can make it happen. And that's
Well, and I think the thing was, is that I was like, don't get me wrong, I believe they did tone it down from where it would have been normally. But as I said, it was that experience when I was in the pirate room and I'm like, that's what I needed. I needed somebody to be like, he was still in there. He was still dressed creepy. He had a, like, musket in his hand and, like, he was, like, pointing to things, like, when, and, like, or he would, like, give it, like, a sentence, which was, like, a hint to, like, what the thing was. I mean, part of the issue was it was so freaking dark in there that we couldn't see the color of the coins, and the color of the coins was indicating what the sequence was. So I'm like, and then we were like adding the, we had a little challenge in that room kind of figuring out the problem. But as I said, it was very, very obvious very early on. He, like, physically backed off. Like, he physically kept himself as far away in the room from us as he could. And as I said, like, he pointed, but he, like, and he, his voice was very, it was very even toned. It, like, it wasn't, I mean, I wouldn't say it was calm necessarily, but it was definitely in that direction. But it was, he wasn't trying to be creepy. He wasn't trying to scare us. And I think that's the thing, is that I think that part of it was, I mean, and I'm just guessing, but I think part of it was these actors were being paid to be there. So I think they felt like they had to be doing something. Otherwise, they weren't doing their job, without realizing that what their job is to enhance the experience for the customer. And if the experience they're giving doesn't match with the customer's needs, their presence could be compromising the experience that the customer has, not supporting it. And so while, like, from a, and I can see it, because I can see a lot of bosses might be like, you're not doing anything, without realizing, unless you can, like, once you start, and this is where, like, if you put the needs lens on everything that you have going on in life, this is what enables us to kind of get what it is that we're talking about here. Because if you put the needs lens, like, yeah, if a person is doing nothing, quote unquote, while being paid, you could see, imagine that a manager or an owner would be like, what the fuck are you doing? Get off your ass and do something. You're being paid to be here. But if you put the needs lens on it and you go, their simple presence is providing the creepy factor to the level where it's not going to compromise somebody's experience. Like, there was interesting that one of the actors in there at the end, now I don't know whether this is part of what the end scene was, I thought it was just a doll. Like, they had some animatronic or, like, human shaped dolls. Most dolls are human shaped, like human sized dolls. There we go. Like throughout the thing, I thought it was a mannequin. I didn't think it was a real person. And it was only at the end that we found out that it was. Now, I don't know whether he would have done that with anybody. And then he would have scared the shit out of you because you thought it was a mannequin and it actually came to life. Or whether that was done because he was trying not to scare us. I don't know what the reality of that was. But even like right at the end, like the very, very end, like as we're escaping, this guy came up behind us and gave a really loud clap. And I know it sounds like a really odd thing to say, but you're already like, I'm on like high alert anyway. And it was right behind me. It scared the shit out of me in that moment in time. Now, compared to what they would have done, that would have been probably much more scaled back based on the screams I heard of the people who were coming out ahead of us. But it's like a level one could be no loud noises, mm-hmm. no loud noises or no movements. You can maybe say something, but you don't move and you don't make any loud noises. Number two is like, you're allowed to make one loud noise at one point during this room. Or like there are criteria you can give, but the thing about it is that the whole point of a customer going through something like that is for them to enjoy the experience. Now, if they like being scared, great, have at it. If they don't like being scared, it's going to actually get in the way of them enjoying the experience. But as I said, this doesn't necessarily just need to apply to haunted houses. This applies to any kind of customer engagement, i.e. if you find out what are the things, if you're curious and you want to learn, what are your customers' needs? What are their wants? What is it that they're looking for from this interaction? What are the bad experiences they've had in the past? Once you know that, you can start to tailor your experience that you're giving them to and again, like it may be another great example. Like if you walk into a retail shop, there are some retail shops which have it whereby anyone who walks in the room, you say hello to, you kind of quote unquote greet. Now, there is a boutique here in Key West where the quote unquote greeting that you get is it feels aggressive. Uh-huh. Every time I walk in there, I feel unnerved by the greeting because it's so aggressive when it kind of comes at you. And it's like, I don't think that's what they're going for. Now, what they're trying to do is engage their customers. But because of how it's done, and like, it doesn't matter where the person is in the store, like a lot of the time they're in the back of the store, but they got to greet you as you're coming through the front. So they shout to greet you. But if you get shouted at the second you walk through the door, that doesn't feel welcoming. It's like, what the fuck just happened? I don't know whether I want to spend a lot of time in there. And I don't like shopping in this boutique as a result. And it could be that they've had these trials with different things. And obviously it depends on the size of store. But like, for example, like if you want help, you grab a blue basket. If you don't want help, you grab a red basket. Because that gives the customer then the opportunity to choose. And like if you want help in somewhere without having to ask for it, if you pick up a certain colored basket, you're going to get someone come up and be like, hey, like I've noticed that you picked up a red basket. Would you like some help? Is there anything I can do to assist you? But if you just want to be left the fuck alone to do your shopping in peace, you can pick the other one. And they know to leave you be. That's another very simple way of, you don't have to necessarily ask the question, but you can provide options that will allow the customer to tell you what it is that they need in that moment and more importantly, what they don't need.
I feel like a lot of times in certain industries, like in certain, especially like shopping kind of experiences, mm-hmm. My husband and I went and we shopped for a couch. If you've ever shopped for a couch, this can be a miserable experience. You never find what you're looking for right away. No, absolutely.
Rarely.
You rarely find what you're looking mm-hmm. for right away. And the standard for a lot of these outfits is somebody stalks you the yes. entire time, no matter what you tell them. Like when we first started looking for a couch, we weren't even in the same state that we were going to buy the couch in. And we tell people, being somebody who's worked in retail and customer service mm-hmm. almost my entire life, at least on the customer service end, listen to your customer. If they say, we're just shopping, like we're just looking around. We'll let you know if we need anything, or like be like, do you want me to check back in 10 minutes with you? No, I'm good. I think we're just going to look around. Like there, right. We got run out of some stores because I'm like, I'm done. Like they're around right. The corner. They're like peering behind pillows, like to see what yeah. You're talking about. And it's unnerving. And like some people right. Want that catered, hold my hand, like show me each couch. The reason why we purchased the couch we did is because the guy left us alone. Every mm-hmm. like half hour he came by, he didn't come into our area, be like, no, we're good. It,
yeah.
Like, felt so comfortable. It's like, okay, like I don't feel like somebody's chomping at the bit for that sale. Like, and that's the thing. Like when somebody wants it too bad, and I don't know if that's like, that doesn't feel like the appropriate phrasing, but it's like,
yeah,
I feel pressurized.
We're on the same wavelength. I think a lot of the time they're so desperate for the commission that they think that by being pushy, and there's this kind of, there's the kind of trope of the kind of pushy salesman, like being the one who kind of like is very successful. And in actual fact, the opposite can often be true. Like the best salesman is the one that best listens to and meets the needs of the client. Like I remember a great example, like my mom and dad years and years ago, they got double glazing windows. And I don't know whether it's a thing in the US, but double glazing is a thing that you like, it's renowned in the UK. Like you never say yes to finding out because you'll never get rid of them. Like you never show any interest in double glazing because you just never will get rid of them. And there were people who came to they would give you like a little presentation in the home and explain what the things were and everything. And they always had this thing, and a lot of places do this, and we'll get to what our sales process looks like. I mean, it's weird calling it even a sales process because it doesn't feel like that.
I don't
like,
do we'll get, sales.
Yes, neither of us do sales. And it's interesting because like when Serena first said I don't do sales, I'm like, well, you do, but you do it in a way that feels good for you because you're helping people find something that would be a fit for them. If it's a fit for them, you're not trying to push something on them that they're not interested in. And that's a lot of the time what people think sales is. I remember that it was early in the year, and it was the person wanted to come and give the demonstration the night of my mum's birthday. And my dad was like, because it was like they had an appointment, and my mom and dad really wanted to get this done. So they were like, he was like, okay, but you literally have like a 45-minute window, and after that we're gonna have to call it because it's my wife's birthday. And so I'd actually been out for the evening. I think I'd been at work. I used to work sort of 5:30 to 9:30, and I got a feeling this person was due there at 6. So like I was already out. I came back at like 9:45 at night from work, and this salesman was still in our living room. The food for my mum's birthday dinner was already cooked and like spoiled in the kitchen. And I remember walking through the door. Now, if anybody knows me, has known me for a long time, my teenage sense was not as demure or mindful as I am now. I was very fiery. I'm not a fire sign for no reason. And I was not somebody you messed with as a teenager. Now, I'm not someone you mess with now, but different energy. Like I was very spicy, shall we say, edgy. I could be very harsh. And I remember walking through the door, and I didn't say this, but I'm like, in my head, I'm like, I didn't want to step on my dad's toes because my dad was kind of handling the situation. And they kept saying to this person, like, no, no, like, we're not going to buy today. It doesn't matter what you said. But they kept offering, like, but if you buy it today, you get this discount. You won't get this discount another time. And they're like, we don't care. We're not buying today. Like, that's just not like. And I remember in my head being like, if this guy isn't out of the house in 10 minutes, I'm going to lob his windows out of our front door, followed swiftly by him. Like, I was so angry that this person was still here and he'd ruined my mum's birthday. And that it hadn't been handled as forcefully as I would have done. I think because the whole British thing, there's a lot of like politeness and people pleasing that goes on.
Can you show me the double painting from the outside, or the double glazing from the outside? Outside. And I'm going to like lock the door.
Right. I mean, I absolutely would have done that. And I would have thrown his stuff over the back fence to get,
his face would have been like pressed up against the window, but I can get you this deal.
Like shut the blinds, like everything. Ooh. I mean, literally, but I would have been like, I'm like, what the hell is happening here? And I'm like, I was ready to get in this guy's face and be like, you have 30 seconds to get out of this house. Not only will you not get the sale tonight, you will never get a sale because of how you have behaved here this evening. Like, leave now, or I'm calling the police and I'm going to tell you them that you're trespassing. Like, that was kind of where I was at. Like,
your
I was
teenager
like,
is very handsy.
Yeah, my teenager's handsy because it wanted to throw hands. Like, I mean, like, I'm like, get out of the house. Get out of the house right now. Now, obviously, I would have said to him, I mean, I would have been really blunt. Like, mm-hmm. You need to leave now. Like, I would have just been like, you are not getting the sale. And the interesting thing is, the guy didn't get the sale. They went with a different company because of how this guy behaved and because he didn't take no for an answer. And it, like, I don't care what discount you're giving me today. The answer is no. And I would be like, you need to leave my house. I wouldn't have even engaged him in conversation anymore. I would have been like, you have 5 minutes to leave my house. I'm getting on with my evening. If you don't leave in the house in 5 minutes, then I'll take further action to ensure that you leave my house. Like, I wouldn't have been like, as aggressive as I was a little bit of an angsty teenager. There was definitely a little aggressive streak within me, which has mellowed over the years. But I would just be like, I would have been like, and the good thing is now I can be very direct and people, it's very disarming for a lot of people because they don't know how to deal with directness. I would have just been like, I'm never buying anything from you. You have 5 minutes to leave or 30 seconds to leave. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I mean, it's funny. Like, there was a, I remember there was a moment where
how gracious we were, am I feeling?
we were actually Serena and I were actually in a bar, and there was a person who I'd met up with previously, and they'd said some things that showed that our values were dramatically different. And I was like, you know what, this person's not somebody I want to hang out with. So I had just not responded to their messages. We were in a bar together, and this person saw me and came to say hi. And I was like, and she's like, oh my God, how are you? And I'm like, I'm good. She's like, yeah. She's like, I didn't hear back from you. I wonder what happened. I was like, I just don't think we're a good fit as friends. And Serena said, like, I remember, and Serena was like, it wasn't like mean. I wasn't being like an asshole to this person. I remember Serena sort of saying to me, like, you were just so, like, she calls it past the salt. Like, I wasn't like heightened. There was no emotion in it. I was just direct and I was honest. Like, and again, it wasn't that like, I don't want to be friends with you. It was just like, I just don't think we're a fit to be friends. And I remember Serena being like, she said, it looked like I'd verbally slapped this person in the face because she didn't expect me to be direct about it, because everybody, and she was also British. So she was expecting me to do the whole British polite people pleasing thing. And I'm like, I'm not going to lie to you and be like, oh yeah, no, I didn't get your message, and then just continue to ghost her. Like, that's not, I just wanted to be honest. Like, I just don't think we're a fit to be friends. So, like, that kind of directness sometimes. And it wasn't like the words I used and the tone I used was very deliberate. It wasn't, I was very careful not to be mean or to be harsh in any way, shape or form.
It was very past the salt for anybody who doesn't know what that means. It's like the same tone that you'd ask to have the salt at dinner. Even if you're mad at somebody, like, try to say pass the salt angrily. It's like you almost have to try to do it. And so that I call it the pass the salt. It's like it was like the void of emotion. And I can only imagine what my face said at that moment. My mouth kept shut. I knew to keep my mouth shut. I was like, oh. Okay. Like, and it threw me off. Because it was elegantly done. I was like, oh, wow, that just shut that down. And like, and I was like, it, yeah, like still to this day, I think about it. And I'm like, it was perfect though, because there was no bullshit around it, which is what the bullshit is, what gets us all in trouble and gets us into these little things. And then they go off. Yeah. Like, there was somebody with her who, like, she couldn't even walk away and talk negatively about it. That's the thing. Like, that's one of those situations that it was like two women and two women were traditionally, like, I don't like to stereotype, but you turn and you're like, what the fuck just happened here?
Right.
But it was at the point where I just looked at Claire and I'm like, oh, okay. Okay. And I feel like that was kind of probably the same thing, because there wasn't like, it wasn't like, oh, she's such a bitch. It's like, because she wasn't. Like, there was, that was one of those things that needed to be on video, because like, it was just
people don't believe it unless they see it kind of thing.
But the fact that it's possible. I don't think I ever would have thought that was possible had I not been there that day, because I know that anything is possible. Like, and we can, you know, like we can do these things, but to actually see it in action and see how it really worked. Like, I'd be scared to be, or in the past, I would have been scared or nervous to have been so blunt and just been like, no. No, like, it doesn't have to be a thing, but no.
And if, and it's like, if she come back and ask me why, there were a bunch of things. Like, there are communities that I am very closely connected to that she was incredibly bigoted towards. And I was like, and the second that happened, I'd met her for a drink because she wanted to some advice on, like, I'd gone through the visa process and she was wanting to go through the visa process as well. And I'd met her for a drink. I had no issue with meeting her for a drink. The second that showed up, I was like, I gotta go. I'm sorry. Like, I don't even think I said I'm sorry. I just said, oh, I'm sorry. It's automatic. Like, but in that moment, because of how she behaved, I'm like, oh, I gotta go. I've got an early day tomorrow, so I'm gonna see you later, kind of thing. And she was like, oh, like, you could see that she was like, I fucked up here. And I think that's the thing. In that moment, when I said, I just don't think we're a good fit as friends, she knew why. Like, she knew the backstory behind it. And I could have put her on blast and I could have raised that. And I didn't. I didn't need to. I just was like, and that's the thing. So that's what I mean, is that now I would deal with things very differently to the way I would have dealt with things as teenage me. But that I would have, but that's, that directness would have still been there. And coming back to the point, like, by trying to, by compromising your customer's needs in trying to get what you want and need, i.e. the sale, you are less likely to get the sale. Like, it's just not going to happen.
And I feel like, it's like, thinking about this from all of the experience that I have in customer service, it's hard. It's hard to tailor and customize the experience. And I think that's why people get into this is what it looks like and this is it, because it's one thing or maybe two things. The payoff for customizing is, goes far beyond the work and effort that you put into it. Because that's how you get customers that you really want to work with. Because the ones, like, if you're not aligned in that and they just want the standard, you know.
Well, I don't know if I believe that that's true, that it's difficult to customize, because I think that people overcomplicated things. So as I said, like, you think about, like, the colored baskets like approach. That's a really simple way of having someone indicate, do I want help or do I not want help? Like, if you think about, like, I know that you used to do concierge service, like, you could have had like a one sheet of one like thing, which is like, tick all of the things that apply. What are you looking for? I'm looking for chilled, I'm looking for fun, I'm looking for adventure, I'm looking for this. And just have them fill that in before they, and I hand it to you. You're like, okay, I can see this person wants a chilled experience. I'm going to suggest that they go and do a sip and sail, or they're going to go and do a sip and paint, or like, those are the chilled experiences. Or they want adventure. Okay, I'm going to put them on the water adventure thing. I'm going to send them to the jumping bridge. I'm going to send them, like, it, like, there's ways of customizing without, like, you don't have to know the person's, like, inner thigh measurement and, like, like, what's the name of their third born cousin.
Depends
twice
what you
want to
do
whatever.
In Key West, but
well, I mean, that's true. But, like, but you can start to, and I think this is the thing, is that it starts with curiosity. And this is where it kind of ties into what I was saying. Like, this is doesn't just apply in business. I saw a video a while back where somebody said that curiosity is the key to relationship. And I think that that's the thing, is that curiosity is the key to any relationship, including business relationships. And I think that's where we forget and we think, oh, this is how it's supposed to be done, so that's what we're going to do. But I think that this kind of curiosity about, like, learning about the other person, learning about what their needs are, learning about what the triggers are in the past, like, learning about the ways that they like to feel supported. Like, the reason that I have two ultra, ultra close relationships in my life. One of them is with Serena. One of them is with my friend Sharona in the Netherlands. And the essence of those relationships, and I have a lot of other close friends as well, which this has happened to a kind of slightly lesser extent. But the reason that Serena and I and Sharona and I are so close is because both of us have been curious and have put effort into learning what works for the other person, learning the things that we do that compromise their needs without us even realizing it, learning the things that we do that supports their needs really in ways that don't take a lot of effort at all. And that curiosity and tailoring what we are doing. Now, what I'm not saying here, I nearly wasn't saying it at all, apparently. What I'm not saying here is you change who you are to be a person that you're not to try to keep the other person happy. That is not what I'm talking about here. What I'm doing is I'm suggesting that we look for understanding the things that we sometimes do without realizing it, that wouldn't compromise us in any way not to do them, that would negatively impact somebody else's needs. Or what are the things that we naturally do and we could easily do more of that would support the other person in getting their needs met? And like, especially like I have like some of my friends, almost all of my friends have ADHD, like it's like a little neurospicy crew. But like, yes, that's true. And our ADHD works differently. It shows up differently in all of us. So I have an understanding of like, I love it and I appreciate it when people pay attention to my specific version of ADHD and how do they support that. And I do the same thing with like what would be supportive to Serena in certain situations versus what would be supportive to Sharona versus what would be supportive to Jason, which was what would be supportive to Woody. All different things. There may be a little bit of a Venn diagram, there's a little crossover, but a lot of the time it's a slightly different thing. So I'm like mindful of like, okay, I'm with Serena now. I want to be supportive. And the kind of support that I offer could look like this, it could like this, it could like this, it could like this, it could like this. These two options are the Serena versions of support. These two options are the Sharona versions of support. These two options are the Jason version of support. And so what I do is I choose from the options that are in alignment with me. But the only way I get to learn that is by actually being curious and by wanting to put the effort into cultivating a relationship that feels mutually supportive.
I also think listening is a big part. I mean, obviously listening is a big part of relationship. Something that I think we all think we do, or most of us think we do better than we actually do on the daily. Like, there are times when it's like, yes, I am focused, I'm listening, but that just kind of daily talk and banter and stuff, like what's being said in there that we're like, oh, never mind, like just kind of brush it off. This is kind of a slightly weird example, but for years I would tickle my husband and he hated it. But I'm like, oh no, tickling is fun. It makes you laugh. And I like the way you laugh. And like, I want to hear you laugh. So I'm going to tickle you. I don't care how much you say you hate. I hate tickling too. Ha ha. I don't particularly tickling doesn't bother me until I get to the point where I can't breathe. And then I can't breathe. I feel like I'm dying. Like, I'd like to stop. But my husband, like, he seriously almost has like a fear. Like, I've stopped in the last like 2 years. I've really started listening and I'd hear him saying, and I'm like, he doesn't like it. That means that every time I do it, he may laugh, but I'm impacting his needs negatively. And that has its own spinoff, which means I'm actually getting nothing out of it. I'm negatively impacting my needs more than I think I'm eating it. And all it took, like, it might have been like a couple of weeks ago. I went to go give him a hug or something and he jumped. I'm like, okay, what's going on? And he's like, I thought you were going to tickle me. I'm like, I really am trying to be mindful of that. I do understand that reaction. And just so you know, like, I am mindfully thinking about it. And like, I don't want that. I don't want you to have to worry about that. But I've literally pushed him into a trauma response where he jumps when I go to hug him because he thinks I'm going to tickle him because he hated it so much. And for years, I was just like, you don't know what's fun.
Right.
Come on, Serena. Well, come on.
And actually, this comes full circle to what we were talking about at the beginning of the episode. So one of the things that, like, a lot of the time, like, the whole kind of prank culture thing within relationships, whether that's friendship, intimate relationship, family relationships, where it's like, people are getting enjoyment or entertainment from scaring somebody else, from making somebody else afraid. Now, if that person has said, I actually like it when you make me jump, I'm on board with this, that's a different thing. I don't think there are many people for whom that is actually true. And I bet there are even less for whom that has been an actual explicit conversation that's happened. And it's one of the things, like, I hate, there are so many of these videos online of like boyfriends scaring their partners. And it's like, and the other thing is, like, you have to also bear in mind that there are kind of layers to this, because if you are talking about a guy who is scaring a woman, women spend half of their lives fucking afraid anyway, because the world is like objectively less safe for them. Interestingly enough, I just finished watching a TV series out of the UK called Curfew, which is in which all men have a 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. curfew under the guise of women's safety. Now, I won't go anything more into it. It was a very, I felt it was really well done. I felt really conflicted as I was watching it, because as a woman, I'm like, well, I'd feel far safer if men weren't allowed out between 7 p.m. and 7 a.m. But I also wouldn't want men to be restricted in that way. And like, it was all men, including gay men, and it would mean that you wouldn't be able to go out with your partner every evening. Like, there was a whole bunch of things. Like, I'm like, yeah, on the surface, it solves one problem, but actually it just made them angrier. And then there was the domestic violence. I mean, there's layers and layers and layers and layers on this. So, and it reminded me of, there was a Twitter thread that went around several years ago, which was like, women, what would you do if all men had a 9 p.m. curfew? And it was things like go for a walk at night, sleep with the window open. Like, there were so many things that most men wouldn't even think about, but that's because the world is objectively less safe for women. And most women spend a large portion of their time with a heightened sense of awareness or anxiety because they're walking on their own, or they're in an area of town they don't know, or they're in a cab or with an Uber driver that is being a little creepy, or like, list however many of these things, or like they have their keys in their hand in case they need a weapon or to be able to get into the house quickly. Like, there's this heightened level of anxiety and a feeling of discomfort and a lack of, but a discomfort in like a lack of safety sense, not like discomfort as in like, yeah, we're learning and growing. No, I don't feel safe right now. Which means that if a guy does it to a woman, there is also a different dynamic that's going on there. Like, a woman's probably going to feel unsafe most of the time. So if a guy then actively makes his partner feel unsafe as a form of entertainment for himself, that's really fucked up. Like, the other way around, you're not going to have quite the same impact, because then guys not going to have the same level of lack of safety because of the systemic oppression and the patriarchal culture we live in. So like, there's layers of nuance to this. This is not like a blanket, like, but I do think that in any situation, if you are getting entertainment by compromising somebody else's needs, think about the interconnectedness. You are going to be undermining your own needs without even realizing it, because you're compromising their needs to try to meet your needs. But the interconnectedness means that you're disconnected from your humanity because you're disconnected from theirs, blah, 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 blah. We've been through this a million times on this podcast. So kind of coming back full circle to the haunted house, most of my people know you don't scare me. Like, I mean, what was really funny was like, when I was in the haunted house, the friend I was there with was like, he was also really kind of jumpy and scared. And all he kept saying was, if you come near me, I'm going to punch you, or I'm going to kick you. Like, I'm not be able to help myself. It's like instinct. It's like, I'm not going to be able to do like, oh, it was like,
be both scary of us. Too, because he's a big guy.
Yes.
And like, he's not always aware. So I could see him being like all arms and legs and just taking shit out. Like, that's a real threat, and probably not in a scary way, but like
in the process. Yeah.
Oh,
but it's like, but I think that, so I'm not saying that this is like, it's only if it's women that's a problem. Mm-hmm. But I think if like, coming full circle, like, yes, it's important that you want to learn about other people's needs in order that where you can, without coming out of alignment with yourself, that you can do things that support them if it is in alignment with you to do so. But the most important thing is to look for the places where you maybe are negatively impacting somebody else's needs without realizing it, without intending to. Because the second you do that, you automatically become less safe for that person. And when you become less safe for that person, go back to the relationships orbits episode that we did, you will naturally get further away. You will naturally slip back further away from them, because the only people you want close are the people who you can trust to not just support your needs, but also not negatively impact your needs. And that's true whether you're talking about a business relationship, whether you're talking about a colleague, whether you're talking about family, friends, intimate partners. That's true across the board.
And one thing I want to really kind of drive home on this is, just because it's not said like explicitly, there's not a sit down conversation saying, I don't like this, or this is how I'm expecting it to be, like, take some, like, you really have to, if you want to be in true relationship with somebody, you have to read between the lines. You have to look through the gray. Like, and
well, you might actually ask the question. Like, it just because they mm-hmm. haven't said, I'm not comfortable with it, you can ask. Like, you can be like, if somebody doesn't like, if somebody seems like they're not really fully enjoying something and not enthusiastically enjoying the, like it's really obvious that they're loving this. If you're not getting that reaction, that's your cue. That's your cue mm-hmm. to be like, hey, just checking in. And you could do this in a business context. Like if you go to greet somebody and they recoil, you could be like, oh, hey, like, I like, it seemed like maybe you want some space to look around. Is that like, I want to help if you want help, but it seems like maybe you would prefer to just shop on your own. Is that the case? Give them the option to say, actually, yes, I would much prefer that. Thank you very much for asking. Or actually, like, I made this joke and it didn't seem like it landed very well with you. Like, did you find that offensive? Is that like, or I tickled you and you recoiled. It's your responsibility as the person doing the thing to check, to see, like, it, don't put that on the other person to have to say to you, hey, you're kind of coming across as a bit of a dick when you do that, because this is compromising my needs. You can ask and invite that conversation in. Yes, you can read between the lines. Yes, you can like look in the areas of gray, but the most, like, there's one really easy way to tell what somebody else is thinking. That's awesome. Them.
Well, shit.
And I think that's the thing, is that we feel like we should know. And I think that's the thing when it comes mm-hmm. to relationship, like, we feel like we should know. Like, we feel like if we have to ask, that we're not doing a good enough job as a mm-hmm. salesman, or we're not doing a good enough job as a girlfriend, like, or we're not doing a good enough job as a friend. Oh my God, I appreciate it so much when the people close to me were like, hey, just checking, like, does this work for you, or would you prefer us to do this in a different way? Or I'm doing this because I think it would be supportive to you. If there's something else that would actually feel more supportive, I would love to know that. Like, and I've had that conversation over and over and over and over and over again with Serena, with Sharona, with other friends of mine. And I'm telling you, it never gets old. And it mm-hmm. always brings us closer. I've never had anyone go, what are you asking me that for? Like, you should know. Like, nobody has ever said that to me. In fact, most of the time, people are like, oh my God, thank you for asking.
This is new.
I didn't know I could share that. And this is when you end up with a different quality of friendship mm-hmm. that most people don't realize is actually possible to create.
Or quality of relationship and customer service. I mean, when I did concierge, people were drawn to me because I didn't have a checklist, but I'm like, all right, what kind of Key West are you experiencing? Are you looking for? You want the touristy one? I had like the list of places that, like, mm-hmm. just that little bit of getting to know you. Like, yeah, I don't think I'm going to see you the next day. Like, this might be the only interaction we ever have.
Yeah.
More often than not, though, I had people coming back. Claire and I, one year, we did a vow renewal ceremony for guests that I had, because they were like, you actually seem to care, and like, we trust you. Can you do this? And I'm like, sure, I can do this. And like,
and you've stayed friends to this, that you're still in touch with them, right?
Yeah. Like, and it's, you can, the quality of all of your relationships can change by listening, by giving options, by just
caring
about what's negatively impacting other people's needs. And I think that's the big thing, is kind of, we tend to put that as the secondary, if at all, in thinking, like, how is this actually impacting the person with me? Because mm-hmm. it can be a lot of little things that add up, and you're like, well, this doesn't make a difference, this doesn't make a difference, this doesn't make a difference. But when you have 10 doesn't make a difference, it adds up to a whole bunch of, like, mm-hmm. oh, here we are, and now I have all these fucking things and I don't know what to do with them. Like, it's putting
the effort in. And the interesting mm-hmm. thing is that that's when the lines of relationship end up like switching and transitioning. So like, I remember the very first like really all out Celebrate Being Alive day that we did. It was 27 and a half hours long. It was a lot. We did a lot that day.
It was epic.
It was epic. Like, we finished a marathon. We did not start the marathon, but we did finish it. We got medals. Like, it was a whole thing. We did, it was a Key West hoopla. Many shenanigans were shenanigans that day. But the funny thing was, that day we were handing out cards to people with like little messages in, like just that kind messages that might make somebody smile. And we gave one to one of the servers at the restaurant that we ate. And that person has now become a really close friend. Mm-hmm. And interestingly enough, like, one of the bartenders that I saw on Saturday, I said to Serena, this reminds me of when we met Jackie, because she responded so well. We clicked, we got on so well. I have no doubt I'm going to go back there and see her again. And she's going to be like, oh my God, it's so good to see you. Like, and the same thing is what, like, we didn't go from like, you're our server to you're our best friend immediately afterwards. Mm-hmm. We kept going back and we cultivated that relationship. And every time we went, we were like, how are you doing? What's going on? Like, we were talking to her about her life more than just like, what are your specials today? Like,
right.
But we cared and we put the effort in. And because we put the effort in, we got a different quality of relationship out. And the interesting thing is it can go the other way as well. Like when we have, like we've had friends who have become clients because we've offered support to them. And so coming back full circle, one of the things I said was I would talk about our sales process. Well, the interesting thing about it is I remember very, like, because I said at one point, Serena, I think you're going to be a really good salesperson for the business. And she was like, I don't do sales. And I'm like, you do sales all the time. You just don't realize you're doing it. The reason is you're not trying to sell to people. And that's the thing. We don't try to sell to people. Mm-hmm. We let people know what we do. We let people know how it can help. We let people know how they can find out more about it, i.e. they can have a conversation with us. Like a low cost introductory session is a discovery session. It's like $47. And then we can have a conversation, like find out more about what they need and how, what we do and da, 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 da. But the thing is, like, I remember so many people who do the sort of thing that we do are like, if you sign up today, you'll get 20% off or whatever, or you'll get 50% off or 75% off and everything. And I remember vividly, I had this conversation with one of my, I did a discovery session with this client. And I remember at the end of the session, I said to her, and this is what I say to all my clients, like anyone who does a discovery session with me is like, I will tell you what we do. You can have a think about it. You tell me how long you want to think about it and when you want to get back to me by. Some people it's like a couple of hours, some it's a couple of days, some it's a couple of weeks, some it's a couple of months. They may have like stuff going on in their lives that it's not the right time to make that decision. And I'll say to them, right, okay, I'll expect you to get back to me by this date because that's what you've told me. If I don't hear back, because accountability is one of the things I do as a guide and a coach and a mentor, I'll check in with you and see if you have any questions or see if like just to follow up with you. But I really encourage you to make that decision for yourself. It doesn't matter if it's a yes or a no, but you making that decision, that's you stepping into your personal power need. You're actually starting to live the work by making that decision for yourself. But you tell me what the time frame is that you want to have a conversation about this, that you want to have a think about this. If the answer is no straight off the bat, I'm like, okay, great. Here's how you can find the podcast. Here's how you can find our Facebook group. Here's other things that are free resources that you can still find out a little bit more about what we do and learn more about it. But the key thing is, and it's so funny, I remember vividly this one potential client. She said to me, wait, you're not going to offer me a special offer to sign up now? And I'm like, no, I don't want you to sign up now. I want you to go away and make sure that you're making the right decision. And I want you to feel good about the decision you're making. I don't want you to feel pressured into it, because if you feel pressured into it, you're not going to feel good about it. And you have to make sure that you're balancing up all the things, like what are your time resources currently? What are your financial resources? If you need to compromise those in order to learn about meeting your needs, you're going to compromise your needs to learn how to meet your needs, which means you're working against yourself from the beginning. So like, where most people would put pressure on people to try and get the sale because they want the sale, I don't want the sale. I want to work with people who it's a good fit for us to work with, who we know we're going to be able to help, and we know it's the right time, it's the right, they're in the right place in their lives, they financially can afford it. And that's the reason we've got like different payment options available, where we can do like different like weekly payments that fit with somebody's budget, and then they'll do a session once they've accrued enough to have their session, because we want to do things in a way that are supportive of people's needs. And that's the thing, is that once you put a needs lens on the sales process, it becomes really easy to be a good salesperson. And by that, I don't mean somebody who sells a lot. I mean somebody who helps somebody find the thing that is right for them. And to ensure that people who aren't right for you don't become clients, because that's not good for you, for them, or for anybody in the process. And I said to Serena, you sell all the time because you just talk about what we like. You can't help but talk about what we do, because like everything you do every second, every day meets your needs. So you end up talking about needs 24/7. Serena has become that chick that talks about needs a lot, which is what mm-hmm. she thought about me when we first met. But it's like, it's natural. Like when you talk about something because you believe in it and you think it's powerful and you think it's supportive. And if someone's interested in finding out more about it, you share more with them. Mm-hmm. And then you help them if they feel like it's a right fit, that they want to find out more and they want to have a session. Great. There's a number of people who have Serena has done that with. But I don't think it's ever felt like you've been selling, right? Because you mm-hmm. know that's not the objective. Like the objective right. is not the sale. It's supporting this person and getting what mm-hmm. they need, right?
Absolutely. And, you know, I came from an industry that was, it doesn't matter if they're the right person, a person is the right person. And mm-hmm. we've seen it not fit well. And like Claire said, that's not good for anybody. And it's like what we offer, it's work. It's work to get to any place that you're not. Like it usually doesn't come.
If you want to transition, you want to change, you've got to put the effort in, right?
Exactly. If you want to grow, mm-hmm. like this, mm-hmm. this helps it. To do it in a, I don't want to say an expedited process, but a more fulfilling process. And like you can
it's
get there.
Compared to a number of other options out there, I think it's like compared to like some of the experiences our clients have with like therapy or counseling mm-hmm. or what have you, they get exactly. there a lot quicker working with us than they do with those. So I think that's a fair thing to say.
Exactly. But yeah, I don't sell. I just talk about what I do. I talk about how it's helped me. And some people mm-hmm. are like, oh my gosh, that's amazing. And some people look at me like I'm full of shit. And I'm like, okay. And that's something too. Like I know.
And then the conversation moves on.
Yeah. Then we start talking about something different because this, okay. I mean, if you want to know more, sure, ask. But like, I'm not going to keep going and going and going on what I do if you're like, no. Mm-hmm. Like, and that's, and to not have that is just like, like
right exactly. And that's the thing is that like, and so it's, but again, that's what we're doing in that is we are responding to the needs of the person in front of us, and we're not going, this is a potential client, what do I need to say to this person to get them to become a client? We're going, there's a person in front of me, I want to connect with this person, I want to find out more about this person, this person is wanting to find out more about me, so I'm going to share about like me and the things I do. And if they want to find out more about that, then I'm going to share more with them because they're interested in that. If they're not interested and they ask about something different, I'm going to talk about that something different. So this is the beauty of this, is that it's not a sales process. And like anybody, I've always said, you put me in front of somebody who can afford to work with me, it's the right time to work with me, and they need what we do, they will become a client because mm-hmm. the conversation will naturally end up following in that way. Because normally what will happen is someone will share about the struggles that they're having, and I'll be like, well, have you thought about this? Or like, we've got maybe a podcast episode that might help with that. Like, and it naturally flows in that direction. There is no need to force it. And by forcing it, not only do you compromise that person's needs, but you compromise their trust in you because you're mm-hmm. crossing boundaries that you maybe are not even aware are there, but also it compromises their opinion of your business or your organization. Like there are companies I will not interact with in any way, shape or form mm-hmm. because of how I've been treated by salespeople, customer service people, because it's like you're a representative of that organization. That tells me what that organization's about, or that's how you're being trained to interact with people. That's not a fit for me. I'm going to go find a one that is. So I'm like, we've kind of gone a little all around the houses with this one, but that's because this kind of principle applies to so many different areas mm-hmm. of your life, and you can apply it in whichever context is relevant to you. You can do the same thing when it comes to your family. You can do the same thing with your friends. You can do the same thing with your intimate partner. But that curiosity and putting effort into finding out how to relate to somebody in a way that is going to be supportive of their needs and more importantly, doesn't negatively impact their needs, it's going to create better relationships in every area of life. Anything you want to say before we finish up?
I think I'm good.
Okay. All right. Well, we will be back next week with another episode, hopefully, as long as the technical problems have been fixed. But between now and then, remember to stay safe, to take care of yourself, and to continue to meet your own needs. Lots of love. Bye.
Bye, friends.
That's it for today.
If you like what you heard
and would like to see some of Serena's awesome facial expressions,
check out the video podcast on YouTube.
And remember, the best way to find out what somebody's thinking and if what you're doing might be supportive or negatively impacting their needs is to ask them.
Well, shit. It really is that simple.